Hey everybody, I'm Christian Schaefer, here with my friend and coworker Nathan Brown, and today we're digging into the air-cooled flat four out of my 1973 Porsche 914. Now, when I bought the car about a year and a half ago, I knew it was leaking oil, and I didn't think it was going to be too much of a big deal. Maybe some pushrod tube seals, maybe a rear main seal. But I pulled the engine once previously, and it turns out that is not the case. There is a plug at the back of the engine, the cam plug, that was put in incorrectly, put in backwards, and then slathered in what looks like JB Weld, and that is not holding any oil.
So I do know a lot about Volkswagens. I know a bit about Porsches, but I actually don't know a whole lot about the air-cooled stuff, and especially in terms of like the four-cylinder. So give us just a little more background on what the engine is and kind of maybe where it came from, beyond just like it's a flat four air-cooled.
So this engine here is called a Type IV. It's found in your Volkswagen 411, your 412, the Porsche 914 four-cylinders, and some later Volkswagen buses. It is an air-cooled four-cylinder pushrod engine, so it uses a single camshaft below the crankshaft here, and pushrods on either side to actuate the valves. It's a pretty simple design, but it's very robust. They made it for a lot of years. It's very popular in the aftermarket, and you can rebuild them at home for not too expensively.
So I'm glad you mentioned the Volkswagen heritage and the fact that it's a bus motor, because my uncle has a bay window, and for years and years and years, he always talked about how he had a Porsche motor in his bus. So is this a Porsche motor and a Volkswagen bus, or is it a Volkswagen engine that goes into a Porsche 914?
Ooh, it is definitely a Volkswagen engine that goes into a Porsche. The later 2 liters that they had in from 73 to 76, they had a Porsche designed cylinder head, but for the most part, this is definitely all Volkswagen here. Okay. It's really nothing too crazy.
So before we start tearing it apart and really digging in, can you kind of go over how the actual air-cooled section works?
Sure,
because it's an air-cooled engine, and that's not real common these days.
Right. So if you're familiar with an air-cooled engine, it's probably going to be the flat six from a Porsche 911, which has this big honking fan on the front, blows over the case. This is not the same. It's a similar design, but smaller, more compact. At the front here is your fan. It looks like the fan from a heater mower, a blower motor out of your heater system. And it sucks in air here and pushes it this way through this duct and over the engine, covered by these shrouds here. And the cylinders on both sides are finned. They are essentially heat sinks, like you would find in a computer or something like that, that the air blows over to cool the cylinders and cool the oil, cooling the engine.
Gotcha. So it's a lot like a motorcycle engine too.
Like very much
see
like
one
a motorcycle
that has
engine.
The little fins
absolutely,
on and stuff.
So absolutely.
When we get the covers off, we'll be able to see that.
To keep these really cool, it needs cold air on the top only and to blow all the hot air down below. So it needs to seal up into the engine bay. That's very critical for these engines. So during this rebuild, I'm going to be taking a look at this tin because it's not in the best of shape.
I mean, I'm excited to tear into it. Curious what we find.
Very curious what we find. My car was originally a 1.7 liter, but when I bought it, I was told it was a 2.4 liter. I have absolutely no documentation for that. I'm not sure how they got to that figure, and I really don't know if it is that big. So this is going to be a little bit of a discovery as we go along here.
We'll have to get the calipers out.
Definitely get the calipers out.
As we start removing the bits to get to the heart of the engine, it is fascinating to see how this air-cooled technology from decades-old engineering makes this unique engine work. Sometimes simplicity is best, and this engine certainly doesn't disappoint. We remove all the tin air ducting and the fan blower to reveal each air-cooled cylinder. So one of the things, we can talk about this as we tear it down more, one of the things that's really interesting about these engines is that it is not a block and a head.
Right.
It's a crankcase.
Yep, and then the cylinders and the heads get bolted to it. The cylinders are all removable, individual cylinders.
So that's basically like how you upsize or increase displacement.
Oh yeah, it's super
you run bigger
easy on
pistons,
these.
You just get new cylinders.
You just slide new sleeves on. Yeah, you slide new cylinders on. So on just about all of these, your 1.7s, your 1.8s, and your 2 liters, the big upgrade or the common upgrade is going to 96 millimeter pistons. That's larger than the 94s in your 2 liter, your 93s in your 1.8, and your 90s in your 1.7. That's pretty much the go-to. You can go quite a bit bigger. People go up to 103, up to 106. This may have that. We're going to find out eventually. We'll see. So missing from this engine was its thermostat, its cooling system.
Wait, it has a thermostat?
It has a thermostat. So obviously there is no cooling system, there's no water, there's no water pump or anything like that.
Yeah.
But on the engine, on the lower side down here, these two studs here,
yep,
would hold like a brass bellow, like an accordion style. And a cable runs this way. Up here, a bar runs across here and connected to the cable, which comes up through here.
Yeah.
And when the engine gets up to temperature, the bellow shrinks and it pulls on the cable and lifts two flaps here that are supposed to be on the bar. The flap on the left side is attached to the bar, so it's not here. The flap on the right side is here, but it's just hanging out. And to make matters worse, this is the one for the oil cooler.
Oh.
So it's just kind of hanging out here.
So basically your oil cooler was not seeing any cooling air?
Seeing very little. I can almost squeak my fingers through this little passage here. But
I'm guessing that wasn't very...
I don't know why. Here's your little flap.
Interesting.
Just hook into the bar here. Yeah.
Do these overheat in traffic or anything like that? Like how does it work as a driver? Like as a car to drive?
I haven't had any issues with it. Yeah. I don't really hear of people having issues with them in Arizona and climates where it's 100, 120 degrees. Running an external oil cooler is probably going to benefit you in a lot of ways. These do have, 914s in general do have hot start issues. The starter kind of sits right over here and there's not a lot of airflow, so the solenoids get a little cranky, but a little simple screwdriver under, jump the solenoid, you're good to go.
It's another bracket. There we go.
There it is.
Huh.
Old.
So is this...
A little gross.
More air cooling. So basically...
Yes, air cooling for the back of it.
So yeah, so it's an air-cooled alternator.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, they're like, yeah, air does everything on this.
Air and oil.
We use the air for the fuel ignition. We use the air for the alternator cooling. We use the air for everything. So what's the oil capacity? This is a wet sump engine?
It is a wet sump. About four quarts, and that's with the deep sump tuna can Johnny on the bottom. Typically, it's going to be flat on your oil pan, but this has literally the shape of a tuna can for another half quart.
That's not a lot of oil. It's not a huge engine, but that's not a ton of oil.
It is not, and it's not. It's fine for daily driving. It's fine for even some spirited driving, autocrosses. But if you want to go to the racetrack and you're using sticky tires, like I plan on doing, you're gonna starve your engine of oil. So dry sump, we'll see.
Fancy.
Fan comes off, then there are four bolts behind it, and then this entire big magnesium assembly here, I believe it's magnesium, should pull right off. All right, and there's your nearly naked long block.
I was gonna say, it keeps getting smaller.
It does keep getting smaller. It is really not a large engine.
No.
I mean, the 80 horsepower they made stock, you don't need a big engine to make 80 horsepower. Well, there's your valve train.
And we've got old school
cork gasket.
Yeah,
those I put on myself, but.
So it's like no wonder engines used to leak at 30,000 miles because you had literal cork as your sealing surface, not like high-tech rubber and Vitone and various kinds of fancy plastics, just cork.
Just cork, yep, held in by pressure.
Never knew that.
So you basically... Wow. So being that this is a pushrod engine, essentially this adjustment right here is how you adjust your valves, correct?
Yep. Yeah, you would loosen this nut here, mm-hmm, and then use your flat blade screwdriver and back them in and out with a little feeler gauge here, and tighten them down once you've got to your desired gap.
So how often do you adjust the valves on something like this?
I've only done them once since I bought it. It depends on your application. If you're a stock system, it doesn't have to be that often, 30,000 miles. If you're doing something more performance oriented, real track days, high performance, honestly, as often as you want, 3,000
like
miles, 5,000 miles,
before,
yeah, before every track
season.
Day, yeah, you might as well, before every season.
Yeah, I've got to say, disassembling an engine without the looming specter of being dramatically damaged from being hydrolocked is both a blessing and a curse. It's certainly not as interesting from like a carnage standpoint,
yeah.
But at least you know you're gonna be able to like take everything apart the way it's supposed to come apart.
just like that. Oh, cooler.
Nice.
That's all it takes.
That's a little easier than a water-cooled car. There's not water dumping out everywhere now. So that looks like those have been replaced, obviously. Those seals and all that stuff.
Yeah, relatively recently, I imagine.
That looks like a fairly modern material. So we have our oil filter right there that we'll take off.
Honestly, we can just take off the mounting bracket here. We don't even have to pull the filter off. I mean, we can if you want, but...
Did you just say we just need pliers?
Yeah.
And they don't come out like as the head comes off?
Nope. You pull them out.
Let's see how this happens. Pliers, folks.
Not bought into it.
Sort of this way.
Why would that ever leak?
Why would it ever leak?
Why would it ever leak? So to be clear though, so these are the pushrod tubes.
Yes, so these are the pushrod tubes here. Your camshaft sits in here. Your pushrod, which actuates your valve this way, runs through this tube, covered in oil, so it stays nice and cool, happy and lubricated.
So when you get a leak on one of these engines, it's probably not unusual for it to be one of these tubes.
Correct. It is very often, watch out, very often those tubes.
Why don't you make it smaller? Yeah.
As you can see, I've never done this before. I've done this once, actually.
And you just replace those?
Yeah, they are cheap.
Cool. So you said there's a camshaft.
Yep.
And there's push rods.
Correct.
Where's our timing belt or our timing chain?
There isn't. The camshaft gear directly interfaces with a gear on the crankshaft, so there's nothing to worry about.
Interesting.
In terms of belt or
nothing to
gear,
worry
I should
about.
Say, yeah. Now we're kind of at the moment of truth here. This is where we kind of get the cylinder head off and find out what this engine is, at least bore-wise.
So this is where you find out whether or not you were duped?
Yes, this is sort of where I find out whether or not I was fleeced. Hopefully these come off nice and easy.
So now that this is ready, do you want to do the honors?
Yeah, please and thank you.
I'll let you reveal it yourself.
Let's see what we got. It's just that easy. I got some shims up top. It's the closest thing you'll have to a head gasket.
Yes, it's the head gasket. It's more this. It's like more of the cylinder, like fire ring gasket, I guess, because essentially it's just metal to metal. There's no coolant. You're just sealing, literally sealing the combustion in. Yeah. How does the head look?
That's a 1.8 head. Dirty. A little oily, at least on the outside here, but not too bad. I mean, definite sealing issues all around here. I'll check on valve sizes, but I guess not too bad from the get-go. Not 103 millimeters, though.
That's what I was going to ask.
No, not that big. Definitely not that big.
Sizable, but they're not.
No, so these are, I mean, I'm not able to tell off the top of my head. Right now we are measuring the bore, the size of the pistons, that diameter of the pistons here, which is half of the equation in determining what the displacement is. So your displacement is determined by the width or the diameter of your pistons and the stroke, how far they move up and down in the cylinders here. So this is the first half, 95.83. So were they 94s or 96s?
Probably 96s.
Yeah, I'd imagine 96.
It was, I couldn't get it to zero. It was like
0.04
millimeters off, so 0.04, I'll take that as a 96.
Okay, so 96 millimeters, which is nice. They're dished, little baby dish at least.
So the cylinder literally lifts
slides
right
off. Yep, if you will. And there you go. There's your cylinder. Rings are pretty shiny, probably pretty toast. I really don't know how long this engine's been in here. At least a decade. I don't think it's ever been apart. So at the very least, some new rings for me.
I was gonna say the pistons
look okay.
I mean, that's a pretty big skirt.
Mm-hmm.
Are they prone to scuffing and stuff like that at all? Or not really?
From what I've seen, no. I really have never heard of issues as far as scuffing cylinders or pistons. Yeah, a little bit of wear, but nothing.
Yeah. Nothing like what I would expect on a lot of modern engines, honestly. That's a pretty big skirt on there to keep it stable in the bore. So we've got the circlips off, and now it's time to take the wrist pin out.
We are going to. So there's supposed to be a light push fit. They've been in here for a while, so they're a little. little on the tough side to get out. I'm not sure I can get that out with my fingers. So we have a brass punch here and a small hammer and a couple light tippy taps.
Yep, there we go.
She comes.
What do we got here?
That is cylinder number, piston number two.
It says number two on it.
Does it?
Yeah, stamp number two.
Yeah, nice.
I'm not really seeing too a lot of wear. Like, no. It's super smooth. There's no galling, no nothing. I mean, everything points to the engine itself being pretty healthy.
Yeah, not too bad. Yeah. It ran well, so that makes sense.
Right.
It's okay.
Right.
On to the next one. So now that we got the pistons off, before we rotate the engine over and do that exact thing on the other side, we're going to remove the lifters from their bores here. So the camshaft you have in the middle behind this oil pump, rotating with its lobes, opening the valves, operating the push rods, but they don't interact directly with the push rods. In between, there is a lifter. It's just a cylinder of steel or iron, and it rides on the lobes of the camshaft and actuates those push rods. So if we flip this over, they would just fall out onto the ground, and I don't want them to do that. So, help of a magnet. Please. Yes, no. There it is.
Yeah.
There you go. That looks pretty good. No concave wear, nice and flat.
Let's wipe just that a off. little tiny little mark on there. So the something that's
Ooh,
worth
man, odd.
Yep, that's nice and clean. So what's worth noting is that because you essentially have a device, your camshaft that's spinning,
mm-hmm.
and you have that's actuating on that any of the cam followers or a lifter like that is, you have a friction surface where it's riding on the cam, but it's actually spinning the entire time as well,
mm-hmm.
which is why it has that little circular mark on it.
Yep,
and it's spinning inside the bores here.
Yes. Yep.
With one half of the cylinders disassembled, the other half needs to also come apart in order to split the casing. This engine is getting a full rebuild, but what we are finding in terms of the condition of the cylinders is impressive given the age of the engine, a true testament to the Volkswagen build quality. At this point, it's hard to definitely tell what the displacement of the engine is without taking some final measurements, so we break out the trusty measuring tape, roughly measure the stroke, and finally get our answer.
Ooh.
Oh.
There are supposed to be fins here that aren't. That's not good.
So,
yeah, cooling fin, that is supposed to be there.
So why would that happen?
Heat stress over time.
Yeah.
Wow. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that. I'm sure other people have, but this is junk.
Yeah.
Time for a new one.
And that, could that also be something attributed to like user error on installation or like some kind of a stress,
Certainly.
Some like stress or fatigue?
Potentially
being
dropped. Yeah, potentially being blasted with a piece of fan blade at speed could also do it. But what I'm not seeing is where it went.
Yeah. I mean, it certainly didn't fall out anywhere.
No, I can only assume it was put in this way, which makes me very sad. But no more.
Yeah.
Garbage.
Do you want to try to measure stroke?
All right, so moment of truth. We have figured out the bores. They're 96s, which is a good sign. It doesn't look too big of a stroke, but we have our trusty tape measure to help us figure that out. This is not
this is
the most exact science.
This is not scientific. This is not the way you're supposed to do this in any way, shape, or form. However, we're taking it apart. We just need a ballpark on it.
It's just a ballpark figure.
It'll be fairly close. So
mm-hmm.
The combustion chamber is pretty much completely in the head.
Yep.
When this piston is all the way at TDC, it's
yeah,
right at the
no,
lip.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So we're basically going to measure from the piston surface to the lip
yep.
and
That's
see where
it.
We're at. So 2 3/4, 16ths, 13/16. 2 13/16. Let's math that out on the internet real quick.
Yeah, and we'll get back to you.
All right. So 2 13/16,
which in
German millimeters
is
a metric.
not the 80 millimeter or 82 millimeter figure I was looking for, which would have made it a 2.4 liter. It's pretty much a stock 2 liter stroke of 71 millimeters. So that puts this at a 2056, which is a pretty common upgrade. It's the typical go-to displacement size you're looking for from a performance Type 4. So
in total, that's basically a 2.1 liter?
It is essentially a 2.1 liter, yes. Not bad, but not the 2.4 liter that I was told by the seller when I bought it. Just in the future, if you're buying yourself an expensive sports car, maybe one built in the 70s, maybe one cooled by air. Doesn't really matter, honestly. If they tell you it's had performance work done to it, make sure you get some documentation, and otherwise pay the money that is original and not high performance. Not too big of a loss for me, but not 2.4. All right, so now that the pistons and cylinders are all out, we're down to a pretty much a naked short block here. Just a last couple few bits, and we are prying this thing open, taking the case bolts apart. All right, so we got the oil pump up here, and then the tuna can, the extra half a quart deep sump, as well as a couple oil sensors and random bits and bobs, and then we'll be splitting it open. Okay, la la la.
All right, so oil pump's off, now what?
Oil pump's off, here we go. Grab a wrench and start splitting the case, taking the bolts off. The bolts are not gonna come out, by the way. They're gonna stay in the case. They have little plastic retainers. They're called vibration dampeners on the inside, so they're just gonna kind of pull out but hang in the case.
Okay.
That's the one.
Whoop. Yahtzee. There you have it.
There you go. There's your split open Volkswagen air-cooled four-cylinder. Oh, nice.
We've got this thing apart. We've got our crankshaft here. We've got our camshaft here. What are your thoughts?
Pretty stock bottom end. Standard crank. No fancy knife edges. No crazy balancing. Stock rods. Not bad. Not 2.4 liter high performance, but a good base. It's gonna be reliable, it's gonna be nice once I put it back together. So far, camshafts are early. We can now see the camshaft, and it doesn't look too bad. There it is.
Oh, yeah.
Cam plug, the whole reason I took this whole thing apart.
The classic $2 part for the $20,000 rebuild. So, very, very direct drive, so crankshaft, camshaft, literally no way for that to fail. Nope. Unless there's some big problems. This drives the distributor?
Yes, okay. Distributor gear.
And this is like a little...
This is your
like
windage tray. Yep, baffle windage tray.
Yep.
Typically, these don't really come with seals on. People forget these all the time, so it's nice to see this one has it.
Interesting.
No fancy marks on the camshaft.
So
not amazing.
Yeah.
Not great. Probably needs a camshaft. That's okay.
So it's interesting that it rides on actual bearings versus just floating in the head,
mm-hmm.
like a lot of the water-cooled stuff.
It's worn.
Yeah.
Definitely can wear. Not the worst, but not amazing.
Definitely got some wear on the bearings there.
Time for a rebuild. The main bearings don't work.
Oh.
There it is. That was sealed. There we go.
All right, so we've got our crankshaft out. We've got basically these bearings, main bearings that are kind of captured on here.
Take the rods off, take a peek at a couple rod bearings, and see what's going on there.
Cool. What's interesting about this is that you basically need a specialty tool to torque this.
Yeah.
Yeah, because you can't get a regular socket on that, because we tried. There you go. Okay, so we look at our main bearing surface there, and then our rod bearing surface there. I mean, that looks really good to me.
Yeah, it's in pretty good shape here. I am liking what I'm seeing so far. We got three rods to go, but that's good news. That's reusable for sure.
Yeah, I mean, like, no need to really dig in and do anything at all. So, I mean, obviously the oiling was doing its job.
Yep.
Never had any issues with starvation or anything there, so not too bad.
All right.
Okay, so we were basically torn down.
Down to the bottom.
Case halves split, crankshaft out.
Yep.
Rods off.
All the way apart.
Everything looks pretty good, honestly.
Not too bad. Happy with it, honestly.
We can check. We like talk about some of the stuff here, but I mean, everything's not too bad.
It's really not too bad. A little pitting in the main bearing journals here in the case. Same thing with the cam here. Nothing, I don't think a little bit of machining work is going to fix. All things considered, nothing to be too upset about here. I would love for it to have been an actual 2.4 liter. That would have been really cool. But all things considered, a 2056 is fine by me.
So basically you have an engine that's worth rebuilding.
Absolutely so.
And
yes.
Has no issues whatsoever that we can tell.
No.
Do you want me to like drop it or like damage it in some way? So you like damage the crank. So you do have to buy
maybe
a stroker
throw
crank?
Throw it across the shop a little bit. Maybe okay. Kick it across the floor a couple of times. I think that'll do it. Yeah.
Just let me know. I can do that for you.
Yeah.
but yeah, I mean, it's been pretty fun, you know, having never disassembled one of these air cooled engines. Super mechanical, super, I don't want to call it rudimentary because there's a lot of little bits and pieces.
Certainly.
A lot of really cool engineering.
Yes, a lot of bit of science in here.
But yeah, it's a neat little project. So
I'm excited for it.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'll be really excited once this is back together and like actually
back in the car. Going to be good to go.
To like see what it can do.
Yeah, hopefully some laps around Landmark Park, maybe a trip out to California for Rennsport. We'll see what happens.
That'd be a good break-in.
Definitely a good break-in.
Okay, so we're done with this engine for right now.
Yes.
But we are not done with the 914 parts.
No, we are not done. Coming up next is the 5-speed transmission that was bolted up to this. We are blowing it apart. It had some grungy first and second gear issues, which is pretty typical for those. So we'll be pulling it apart, taking a look at those synchro hubs, those synchros, and seeing what's going wrong there. Now, if you like this video, check out our channel. There are quite a few more engine teardown videos, maybe a twin turbo Cayenne V8 or a BMW M54 with a hole in the block. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and hit that bell for those notifications in the future. Thanks for watching.